This old house, my time in the Fitzgerald house. Have you ever walked by an old house and wondered who may have lived there? Let's talk a moment about Zelda Fitzgerald, and her husband, F. Scott Fitzgerald's their lives that have been chronicled in books and film. But there is much you don't know. Their lavish, extravagant lifestyle led them into financial chaos and the stock market crash of 1929 left them penniless. In 1930, Zelda was diagnosed with schizophrenia and spent the rest of her life in and out of psychiatric hospitals. She died when the hospital she was in caught fire. Somehow the families managed to hold on to a few properties and pass them down to one writer after another. Some say the best writers are the crazy ones, and the hospitals were built to calm our voices, both on paper and the ones in our heads. My grandmother was named after Zelda, and for a while, the naming worked. She worked on many novels and short stories, many of which would bring her awards she would never accept, because you see, in her mind, the awards should go to the readers. The writers are just hardwired connections to both past and future events. It sounds like the crazy talk, I know, but when you pick up an old book and start to flip through the pages, sometimes you can hear and see the things in today's world that the writers of the past spoke of. Some time ago, and many years after my grandmother passed away, I moved to a sleepy little town somewhere in America. I don't see a reason to name the place. Because towns like that don't change, the people that live there are lost in a time warp of their own making, and this story could bring curious onlookers and adventurers to a place that refuses to understand or deal with the future. My family had to move away due to work, the same work that brought us there, to begin with. Sometimes I daydream of what our family would have become if we stayed and how the time warp of the past would have affected them. But I know that once a place takes hold of you, it owns you. Sometimes the best jobs can be the worst ones. They offer perks such as cars and houses to use while you're there. This job offered that, a house and an old green Buick that belonged to the editor of the local newspaper. He was a curious man. A writer who wrote under a few pen names, because he feared what others would think. Like many of us, see fear as the yellow backbone of the pen name. But pen names have a way of creating ghost and dead writers that fill the walls of closed bookstores and libraries. It's hard for me to read a book from a person that screams about copywriters and laws. For some reason, it makes me think they care more about what they make than what they do, and frankly, this isn't fair to you. The house we got to stay in was a large, simple white house with a large locked basement. One of the house rule, one of the only ones, was this: leave the basement as it is. The basement hadn't changed since the house was built, and each owner that would pass it along had that one request cemented into his or her will. Besides our new house, was another smaller home that had suffered a fiery fate. The burnt-out shack must have been servants' quarters at some point and was left to the wills of nature. Our unpacking day, as any unpacking day, was filled full of tears and laughter. The kids played out beside the burnt-down house as me and the wife set up each of our bedrooms and my office. Regardless of where we ended up, the last two things on the list are the kitchen and the book room. She would work in the kitchen as I set up the book room. We were both were admitted readers and had more books than one could ever need. Most nights, if I wasn't working, and after the children went to sleep for the night, we would join our books for a new or old nightly mystery or adventure. Looking back, I should have done things differently. As I unpacked the books, I found that I had more books than shelves, and something that really bothers me is for books to sleep on the floor. They must live on shelves and must show us their spines. To see the books are one thing, but to run your fingers across their backs and find the one that needs to be scratched helps you enter the world of the writer. Sometimes I wonder if people heard the screams from the books as the Germans burnt their books. For there would be a tear in my eye, and I would surely have a broken heart. My daughter came running in to find me in this rather rotten state when she asked what was wrong. I simply told her I was in need of a shelf for the last of our books. "No worries, Daddy," she said. "The little girl showed me one in the burnt house. She grabbed my hand, taking me out the door and to the front of the house that sat beside us. From the black burnt-out doorway, I spied an old shelf. Looking back at my daughter, I asked, "What girl?" "The girl I was playing with, Daddy. My daughter has a wonderful imagination. One day I think she will write fiction that will curl the toes of the critics." So I didn't ask many more questions, but I should have. I made my way past the burnt-out steps and the death trap of a doorway. From the inside you would have thought the place just had burnt, many of the windows and picture frames still hung unbroken, stained with black soot. The house was nice at some point, lively dressed with old green wallpaper, but my eyes zeroed in on the shelf. Along the top was an old copy of Tom Sawyer and an old child's book. The shelf was old but looked new and untouched by the fire. I handed the books to my daughter, who set them on the steps and wrestled the shelf out of the burnt-out house. It seemed to be a perfect fit for what I needed and where it needed to go. After bringing it in, I asked my daughter where were the books that I handed her. It was only right to keep them on the shelf as well. She said they were still on the steps and was about to run out to get them when my wife called the kids for dinner. Telling my daughter to go eat and that I would run out to get them, I grabbed a flashlight and ran across the yard to the old house. Maybe by taking the old books and the shelf I committed some unspoken crime. Upon picking them up I was pushed back by something, I couldn't see, but it moved and twisted, hitting me over and over in the stomach. The flashlight wouldn't shine through it, whatever it was. It just kept knocking me back until I stepped onto a board that had fallen off of the side of the house. A large rusty nail impaled my foot. Still in my hand was the books. I took my other foot and pushed the board so that the nail would slide out of the bottom of my foot. The black shadow of a thing seemed to be pleased with my pain and moved and twisted as if it was dancing in happiness. From my position on the ground, I could see my wife and children eating at the kitchen table, talking and laughing. They were happy. They didn't need to know about this. I didn't think we would be here as long as it was just another step in our journey. So I forgot about the shadow creature that beat me down like a dog because maybe I had done something I should not have. The next few days were normal as normal goes. I limped and worked. Each night my foot would burn and throb. I knew I may or may not have had an infection. Unsure about the local doctors, I remembered my wife had packed the children's leftover pink stuff the doctors gave them for a cold, so I made my way down to the refrigerator and found the bottle and took a swig. Just as I was getting over the bubble gum taste of the amoxicillin, I heard the cry of a kitten. Looking around, I couldn't find it. I limped back up the stairs to my warm bed and my sleeping wife tapping her on the arm, whispering, "I think a cat is in the house." She responded by hitting me in the head with a pillow and telling me to go to sleep. As the next few days went by, we heard the cry of the kitten but couldn't find it. One night, the children asked us to read them a story, so we all made our way to the book room. Each of us looked on in shock as we watched a kitten cry, walk a bit, and then turn into a gray baby. When I say gray, I mean the life looks like it has been pulled right out of it, but it walked slowly toward the bookcase, looking back at us with hollowed blackout eyes. As it reached the bookcase, it turned into a small girl, who was dressed in a dirty nightgown. My daughter perked up and said that the girl, my friend that I was playing with the day we moved in. The girl looked at me as she reached the bookcase and started to sneeze. Gobs of what reminded me of the contents of a cracked egg hit the ground and turned into sheets of paper. The wife quickly gathered the kids and took them to their rooms, looking back at me, with that "what the hell was that" look. My wife could handle most of anything, my stories and nightmares. She was a hard woman and for some reason, this didn't seem to shake her. Later that night when I asked her if this frightened her, she simply said, "No, I just found it curious." The papers that hit the floor was covered in a slimy mess and on each was typed basement. For the next few days, we didn't see the girl, but we heard the kitten. It sounded like it was in the floorboards, the walls, and would move from room to room. As each night went by, I would lie in bed at night thinking of what may be in the basement. The pink stuff wasn't doing the trick, so I ended up at the local doctor's office over my foot. The doctor was a long-time old resident of the town, and when I asked him his opinion about the house and the burnt-out one, he laughed and said, "You must be the new writer. Writers and their families only live there and it seems they always leave with a story to tell. He went on to say it was very sad as to what happened to the little girl and her family that lived in the small house. I was just a young doctor then, and I was called out there because the family had grown sick. They had it all or at least that what it looked like flu, tuberculosis. Their faces were coved with black spots. I had no choice but to tell the sheriff and friend this is something I wished I never did. Back then people were scared and they would go and get drunk and do stupid things. Word got out that the family was sick and we had no idea what it was or how to fix it, and one of the locals went out and firebombed the house in hopes that whatever they had would not reach the rest of us. This is something I will have to deal with for the rest of my life and it may be something I will have to answer for in hell. I just wished I dealt with that poor family a different way. The doctor finished up with my foot and said if you take the medication you should be fine, but if I were you I would stay out of that old house. It's been 50 years but there still might be something lurking in there and come back when you write something or get sick. I got a whole room full of books from people that have lived in Zelda's old place. I got home much later than I had hoped. I made a cup of tea and found myself in the book room with an old magazine. Looking down I thought I seen the blur of fur and the eyes of a cat. It hit the bookshelf that I had borrowed from the old house and I heard the sound of metal hitting the floor. I got up still a little dizzy from the pain medication the doctor gave me and spotted a skeleton key resting beside a fallen book. Something told me this opened the door to the basement. Behind the door, I heard the ancient sound of a typewriter.